The College of Complexes is going to hear from Greg Sedbrook, who will tell us how to find really good chocolate.
Yeah, yeah. All right, Greg.
Yeah. Without having to go to Cote d'Ivoire.
Hello, I've been a friend of Peter's for about 20-some years probably, so he asked me to do this, so we'll see if we can have some fun tonight. Anybody have any chocolate experiences that they'd like to share?
I can say just do one word, okay? I like chocolate very much.
Okay.
And I'm from Europe, and I'm spoiled by German, very good, not Belgium, not French, but German, very good, sweet, bitter chocolate. And I like chocolate very, very much. And
good, you're still alive.
Okay. Hi, my name is Pat, and I'm a chocoholic.
Yeah. Oh.
Well, what step were you at? There was the time when I walked into my mother's pantry about 55 years ago, and I opened a package of what looked like a chocolate bar. I bit into it. Well, it was chocolate, all right. If you probably guessed, it was a package of Baker's Brand unsweetened baking chocolate.
There's the X-Lax, too. I hope you didn't find
out.
Unsweetened Baker's chocolate and chili. It's good.
Okay, good.
After I had my triple bypass surgery and I found out I was diabetic, I found a type of a chocolate bar called Pure Delight. They made a bittersweet chocolate, they made a dark, and they made a light milk chocolate, all sugar-free.
Good.
One day, I used to buy a whole box at a time. One day, I went to the health food store, and I was told the company went out of business. No more Pure Delight chocolate.
Oh, so they're not? Yeah, otherwise, I'd have passed
very
that on to people.
Very good tasting chocolate.
Yeah, I have occasion to travel around a good bit in the United States for the government and the service of the people. But in my traveling bag suitcase, I always carry a big chocolate bar of chocolate. In the event I arrive late or there's no restaurant open or something like that, then I've been doing that for many years. You just have something with me, you know.
Yeah, it's probably one of the most amazing, inexpensive luxuries and taste stimulants you can find. So,
one of the joys of riding a bike in Chicago, here, if you take the bike lanes on Kinsley Street, you go past Blotter's Chocolate. It seems like they're always doing something there because the aroma of chocolate is in the air as you pass through. It's a wonderful stuff.
Good. Later on, we'll ask people if they've got any chocolate resources that are local that they'd like to share. So that we'll see if we can cover that. But usually, when I do this, I start off telling people to start paying attention to whether it's chocolate or sugar that they're getting or something else. Because if you look at a chocolate donut, it's usually some sort of confectionery coating, and if you taste it next to something that's actually chocolate, you will find just very little chocolate taste there. And usually, probably one of the best ways of starting to sort that out is one of the easiest quality bars to find at a reasonable price is the Lindt Excellence bar. I think that's about $2 in a Walgreens or something like that. And so if you get that and you start comparing, because everyone's taste is a little different, so, but if you get something like that, you'll you'll have a reference for the chocolate taste. And then you may find some chocolate that's four times the price that, you know, doesn't even compare with the $2 bar. You might find a dollar bar that's even better. So, but the important thing there is to start paying attention. And, you know, America probably doesn't even have a language of taste like Europe does. So, you know, you can almost think of the Eskimos and snow thing. That if you've got words for it in your culture, you start paying more attention. So, yeah, if you go to France, I mean, they really want to know what field some radish came out of, so they don't just want lettuce to put it with. So, that's a start, and I've got a number of books and resources up here. The I happened to be in Italy and went to a chocolate festival way back, and it was when all the Perugia, or the Perugia, Italy, would bring in all the best chocolate people from around the world, and there really weren't that many at the time. And I got a chance to have lunch, meet, talk with Chantelle Cody. She wrote this book, The Chocolate Companion. And she did do the best job of finding the best chocolates anywhere. And there's two editions to this, and I think they're like a penny on Amazon, plus postage. Both editions are worth getting. The second edition came out when web things started getting better. And so she maybe, or didn't put in a lot of the ones she had in her original book. But you could go online now and check if they're still in business and their website. Yes?
Chantel, you said?
Chantel Cody. All these books will be up here for you to look at, too.
You know, it's a little bit, I'm concerned, because sometimes I'm shopping the dollar store, you know, like dollar store for some items, like household items. And they sell chocolate, like Hershey bar, for instance, or Maudi, or whatever. And white chocolate, so to speak, and pretty cheap, which good bread. But you know what? Sometimes when I approach those register for of chocolate, okay, I'm so appreciated for opportunity. But same time, sometimes I said, huh, the dollar store, and they sell a little bit cheaper. Are you sure it's like real chocolate? Maybe it's some imitation, and it's like bothering me really, and sometimes, should I buy Hershey or not? It looks like label and everything, but I want to be sure it's natural chocolate they sell in dollar store, because it's more expensive store. Hopefully it's very good quality chocolate. I hope this chocolate is good. So what's your opinion?
Read the labels, first of all, and I'm glad you brought up white chocolate, because the white chocolate that is pure white, like this table, is usually palm kernel oil or, let's see, what's the other word they, there's another word.
Partially hydrogenated.
Okay.
That's bad.
That is the bad stuff. So the white chocolate is part of the cocoa bean, and actually they separate the cocoa butter from the cocoa liqueur, they call it. And then if they're going to make cocoa, they dry that and grind it. And then add some cocoa butter back into it.
Do they have to bleach it to make it white or what?
No, that's actually, it separates.
Huh.
And the cocoa butter comes out, and then the chocolate liqueur. Mm. And then, like on a lot of chocolates, they'll add, or most chocolates, they'll add a percentage of the cocoa butter back in. And like I say, the pralines are the usually the better chocolates. And I like to differentiate between candies and chocolate, because your chocolates will be mostly chocolate, or they'll have things with them that complement the actual chocolate taste, like possibly cherry liqueur. Coffee and chocolate go good. hazelnuts and vanilla, lots of other things, and the good chocolatiers too. It's almost like a family secret, you know, the ingredients. So a lot of that you won't find. And the other thing I'll mention along those lines too is the percentages.
Right.
Because you can usually the word milk and chocolate shouldn't be in the same sentence, but there I have had some good milk chocolates, and some of those maybe are around 30 to 40% chocolate. And actually, your real good chocolates are your darker chocolates, and that gives you the full chocolate taste. But on the percentages, what's going on there is the marketing people have used these real high percentages to try and substantiate quality. But the quality has to do with the quality of the beans that were bought the first place, and then how they grind it, or conch it is the word. So if they grind it good, they've got smaller particles that'll actually give you more taste. So you can get a 90% chocolate they didn't grind very well, and you know, and it wouldn't be as good as maybe a 50% chocolate that's well done. So you watch for that sort of marketing thing, and anything that's sort of like a gimmick, stay away from. You know, like the Easter bunnies or things like that. There's a chance you can find some good Easter bunnies, but yes.
I have a question for you. There is a Polish chocolate, and it's 90%. Great price. It's very dark, but there's something very suspicious in there that I would like to know. What is E3 or 536 or 26?
I'm agreeing.
What is that?
I honestly don't know, but I just stay away from
that's
it.
That's scary,
and,
right?
And actually,
when there's a number and a letter,
let me answer the question.
And they don't say what it is.
Exactly. I'm not buying Polish chocolate.
Food. Yeah, in the Eastern.
You don't trust the Polish chocolate?
No.
Why?
No. I got my reason.
Can you share with us, though? I'd like
okay,
to know.
Okay, go ahead.
I found that 90% is hard to find.
I know, I understand. But
and it was reasonable.
But you know, I'm a little bit, I can a little bit argue because, so, I'm from Europe,
questions?
Which is close to Germany.
Yes.
And in Germany, in Europe, the best chocolate it was called really German, bittersweet chocolate, Germany.
Or even not Swiss, right? Swiss has good chocolate too?
Bittersweet.
Okay, yeah. We'll fill you in on that.
It's not Polish, it's not Belgian, it's not French, it's not Italiano.
The Eastern blocks are
German
just generally
chocolate,
lower
best.
Quality. And actually probably the best bulk chocolate is Valrhona from France. Valrhona, V-A-L-H-R-O-N-A. They're from France, and actually they're by Lyon. And actually they started a what's called City du Chocolat, C-I-T-E-D-U-C-H-O-C-A-L-A-T. It's like I'm not sure exactly how, but I've been going to go on the web and see if YouTube has pictures of it. But it's sort of like a theme park for chocolate with really good information and things like that. But they are a really good quality, so I'd like to get over there sometime and give that a try. If anybody wants to do chocolate tours of Europe, I can do it. And beer tours in Belgium. So,
what did you go to Rome for? I'll check on that.
But
sorry.
The another area of chocolate that was probably one of the earlier ones is the hot chocolate drink. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, we've all heard of the Mexico Montezuma chocolate, and they put chili, vanilla, cinnamon, and a lot of sugar because. You can find in a lot of the stores some like South American or Mexican bars that you just break up and put in a cup of hot milk.
Wow.
Well, their refrigeration, they was sort of a luxury up until recent years. And so they would put a lot of sugar in these bars and then just do mostly things like hot chocolate, which was pretty good. And you can actually, like if you go to Mexican food stores or whatever, you can find some of these, and they're pretty interesting to experiment with because wow, they have like cinnamon and nutmeg and lots of other interesting sort of coordinating spices in them. And some interesting history is that these chocolate pots, and there are some antique ones. This is a William Sonoma modern one. And this is from Mexico. It's called a molinillo. And that's what the forerunner of the Mixmaster. They use it to whip up the chocolate. The William Sonoma has a battery operated one for modern days. So, on the chocolate pots, chocolate came actually with Columbus back to Spain, and what they started doing the drink, and it was mostly for the rich people. And actually, Marquis de Sade was really hot on chocolate, and one of the things that got him jailed, and it was considered pretty serious at the time, was giving chocolate to low-class women. But finishing this story, the rich ladies actually got the church to declare that chocolate was not breaking their fast before communion. And so the servants would deliver bring the chocolate pots in, and there's actually matching cups that go with these. And actually, this is a classic shape, and I was traveling quite a bit, so I had an old pot that had there's a little curlicue on top of these generally, so I just brought my old pot, but this is the classic shape. So if you're in antique stores and you see one of these marked coffee or a teapot or set, usually the coffee or teapots or sets are about half the price of what the chocolate sets are worth. And you could go on eBay and look up chocolate pots.
So this is for hot chocolate?
This is for hot chocolate, right.
Wow.
See, it's got the spout up at the top rather than, you know, like the tea or the coffee, you have a strainer in them possibly, or come off the bottom, or there's a number of variations. But this is the classic shape for the chocolate pot, but there are some of the other shapes. Like this one, because this is an antique, and you see it's similar, but, you know, bulbous rather than that sort of, you might say, chimney shape.
Like it's
been
marijuana.
Okay, let's see. Chocolate
Ernie,
festivals
right now.
Are something that's pretty interesting. And like I said, the one in Perugia, Italy, I mentioned, that's usually about the 1st of November. If you go during the week, they have about a half a mile of chocolate stands, and all good. But the weekends, the town is so packed you can just barely move. There's another in Paris, France called Salon du Chocolat, and it's on the web, and it's usually about the first part of November too. And it's only about 10 euros to get in, so it's really good. It has the best chocolatiers from all over. They were doing it in New York, or bringing it over, but they were mostly getting sort of local people, and it really was not worth the money, the trouble to get to New York, and the quality I didn't really think was all that well.
So may I ask you another question, if I may? My favorite subject. Wait a minute. We have a question period,
and you know it. Okay. Now, follow the rules.
Okay, we'll follow your rules.
We'll try and talk
about local information on chocolate, too, and quality, because besides the European, there are European styles or chocolate makers in this country who've sort of done their homework, and their chocolates are very similar to the European. In fact, Leonidas Belgian chocolatier used to be in town here. Leonidas was a manufactured Belgian chocolate, and they really did do an excellent job for the price. But the price was maybe a little higher with the shipping here. The Godiva, it does a fairly decent job, but I usually buy them when I can get them for about half price. You know, like right after the Valentine's Day or things like that. And back to chocolate festivals, the Smithsonian does a chocolate event that's usually before Valentine's Day. And actually, it's good to go on the web if you're looking for local chocolate festivals and search that usually about the 1st of January. And then around Valentine's Day is when there are a lot of events. And so they're usually worth looking into. I'm down in Florida in the wintertime, and there's a Fairchild Botanical Garden down in Miami that right at maybe about the 25th of January always has a chocolate festival, and it's well done. They actually have chocolate trees there too.
Where? In the
Botanical Garden in Miami. So, like I say, usually the chocolate trees are a little bit further south.
Are you in the mood for chocolate, David?
Me. Hang on, I gotta get a shot.
The other thing on chocolate festivals, let's see.
That keeps changing,
so you probably better keep up on the web with things like that. But I've caught them in Brussels, and I think Salon du Chocolat is trying to expand around the world too.
With their chocolate festivals.
So you could try and catch up on that.
This one?
Chocolate theme parks, there's the Dalrota one that I mentioned by Lyon, France. There's the Cadbury one in Birmingham, England. And let's see, unfortunately, the one we have in the United States, I think people know about it, and I usually don't like to say that name. So, because if you taste that particular chocolate, Peter, do you have that bar with you?
Yes.
You can maybe hold it up so I don't have to say that name.
You don't have to say it.
If you will taste this next to good chocolate, it'll taste like sand in comparison. So,
it's a Hershey bar.
Let's see.
What's the best chocolate for coffee?
Chocolate to blend with coffee or
yes.
as a drink?
Yes.
You could probably try Drost, the cocoa. Mm-hmm. Something like that, or you can find a decent chocolate bar and melt it in there. And actually, that's one of the areas I was going to hit is like Trader Joe's, World Market, Whole Foods is a little expensive.
You're welcome, Lana.
Sometimes they do some good things.
I can have
it. Sorry.
Anybody help me on sort of good sources for chocolate around Chicago?
Richmond, Illinois.
Blomer's does maybe has a little bit of dark chocolate, And a lot of their, it's okay for the price, but a lot of their chocolate isn't the higher quality. Of course, they're trying to do American market. Okay, you did.
Yeah, do you mean like where you would shop as a grocery or like a chocolate shop where you where they're already made?
Actually, both.
Okay, there's one in Naperville.
You remember the name of it? Or
Le Chocolat du Bouchard.
Okay, I haven't hit that one. I'll have to try that.
Definitely.
And
Anderson's Chocolates up in Richmond, Illinois.
Peter.
Where's Richmond?
Can we make a... Whoops, okay, sorry. I was wondering if we can make a note of these resources.
Anderson?
Richmond, Illinois. It's up north of Hebron, on route just before you get to Route 12 in Wisconsin.
Yeah, it's on Route 12 on the way to Wisconsin.
Yeah.
Okay. And
Let Them Eat Chocolate on 5306 North Damon.
Yay.
Okay.
Mom, did you want to say something?
Good, he's getting them. If you missed any, let me know, and I'll have people repeat them again for you.
There's Margie's Candies on Western Avenue.
Margie's on Western Avenue.
And then there's Ghirardelli downtown.
Okay, yeah, that's right. And actually, Hershey's is
across the street.
Right across the street.
What's that one that used to come out of Marshall Fields, those candies?
Oh, yeah.
Frango.
Yeah, especially the mints.
Those are chocolates that have lots of preservatives and junk in it.
Right, well, we're sort of going for personal taste, and we're also going for quality. We're doing quality, but, you know, if people have personal preferences, there's nothing wrong with that.
That's right, it depends.
Tootsie Roll.
I don't think there's a lot of chocolate in it. Now, if you go up to Evanston,
no, but it tastes absolutely wonderful.
On the L and the Main Street stop, there's just sort of kitty corner to the northwest across, there's a good one too. Mm-hmm. And I can't quite remember the name of that.
Oh, sure, honey.
What about C's? I would actually designate those as an excellent candy, but their chocolate really isn't good. But their flavors and their other candies are excellent.
Oh, so it's not a good place for chocolate.
It depends on price, depends on personal preference. Okay.
Right near Greektown there, on, I think it was on Washington Street, there was a place called like South Bend. If anybody else remembers it, like South Bend Chocolate or something like that.
South Bend Chocolate?
Does anybody remember that? It was on, like, right by Greektown? Wow.
Okay.
It was a really good place, but I don't know what happened. The address was 847. I remember that. It was like the area code.
Anybody got a smartphone or whatever? But anyway, some other chocolate trivia is... anybody remember Ambrosia Chocolate up in Milwaukee?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Anybody famous associated with that? How about Jeffrey Dahlberg?
Mm.
He used to work there. Was it just for some chocolate trivia. The other thing I'd recommend is if you're going on vacation somewhere, like San Francisco or New York or
Vegas.
Yes, Vegas is actually pretty good. And in fact, I think they've got a Mars, it's not real good chocolate, but I think they do a tour of Mars chocolate there. And they do have a premium line that they'll sell at their factory. And I think it's actually cheaper in one of the department stores downtown. There are a couple of other shops that from Europe and whatever too.
There's some place like in Green Valley where they actually make the chocolate. Because I remember getting samples on the way up. I can't remember the name of the place now.
Mm-hmm. It's easy to find on the web because I've been there. And the other thing in town here,
the
Peninsula
Vegas
Hotel.
It's like a supper.
Does a chocolate buffet, and I think it's usually from about 6 or 7 on Friday and Saturday night. And It's $40 now. It's interesting. It's worth doing once or for a special occasion. But if you have dinner, it's only $20 as your dessert supplement. So I did it once and was just going to go in for the chocolate bar. And their dinners were reasonable enough that it made it worth doing the dinner and then getting the chocolate.
What place is that?
It's the Peninsula Hotel.
Oh, Peninsula. Okay,
plus you
thank
get
you.
Free jazz ensemble.
Right.
And they're always good.
Good. And actually there was a lady that was doing, I'll finish this up and then we'll catch it quick. There was a lady that was doing chocolate tours of Chicago. And it was a decent job, a little bit pricey, $50. But she did a good job. But I think their website got hijacked. So you can probably fill, if you're interested in that, you can fill yourself in locally here. I think there's usually at the Water Tower visitor information, they usually will have flyers or something. So, okay, and you found something for us?
Yes. Next weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, is the Long Grove Chocolate Festival in Long Grove, Illinois.
Oh, okay. Good one. Yay.
If you've never been to Long Grove, it's well worth it because the city is also preserved in some of its more antiquarian times. It's up north on Palatine at the end of 53. You're just going to Long Grove, and they got a lot of confectionaries, a lot of specialized shops that specialize in chocolate. Right. I'd forgotten that a couple friends of mine used to love going there during that chocolate festival, and really you could eat like a, if you like chocolate, it's a pig's delight.
Ah, good. Oh, now that you mentioned that, there's Burlington, Wisconsin has a chocolate festival put on by Nestle. The time I went, I could hardly find dark chocolate. And Nestle knows better. You know, they come out of Europe. They actually bought up Perugina, the Rocci chocolates, the Italian ones. And let's see, Hershey's bought up Scharfenberger out of San Francisco, and Joseph Schmidt, the ones that sort of were really good big truffles that look like half of an egg.
Oh, truffles.
So, but truffles, bonbons, those are the ones for
this
truffles. Okay. Oh, and had you found something else you wanted to mention, or did I just...
Long Grove, they also have other festivals like Strawberry Festival, Apple Festival,
okay,
stuff like that. So it's year round.
Good tip on Long Grove.
Oh, in Russia, it's name of the company Karakum. You know, it's for the dessert in. Okay, it's called Karakum.
Okay.
Karakum. Karakum. It's name of the desert in Uzbekistan or some Asia. Oh, it's one of the best in Russia company. You know how long this company, very, very long time. I suggest you try. I don't know. You know where you can go? Go to Fresh Farm and Wheeling.
Okay.
They have Karakum. You can ask Karakum.
Somebody got that, let's see, on our list?
Oh, delicious. It's like, it's in labels. It's look very colorful. Also, you can try Divan, you know, Divan Market.
Okay, Divan Market
Divan
or Fresh Farms in
Divan and Francisco.
Wheeling.
Francisco and Divan, they have Greek store. It's called Fresh Farm also. They also selling by packages, Karakum. You should check.
Okay, I'm game.
It's really dark chocolate and it's with, you know, with little crushed hard candies, but very, very, it's like really piece of glass, you know what I mean? It's like you eating, it's like crunchy, and same time it's soft, and it's very, very, very good dark chocolate. So I suggest.
Okay.
We got it.
It's called Karakum.
Good.
It's gonna be the afternoon.
Let's see,
she's doing more talking than you.
Oh, okay, that's what I was gonna mention. The truffles and the bonbons, you'll hear the word tempering with chocolate. What they actually do is heat the or they have a little electric heater, usually a unit, and they will heat some of the chocolate up to a little higher than normal temperature. And then they will take the fondant, which is the chocolate when it's pure is sort of semi-liquid, and so it melts very easily. But what they mean by tempering is they'll take some of the chocolate, and if they heat it up, it makes it harder. But it destroys a little bit of the taste. So what they do is they use this for the covering, like they will dip the better quality chocolate in it that's got the recipe with like the nuts and the cherry brandy and the vanilla and things like that. Some other sidelines here. Have people seen Teavana around town? They're a new tea store. They're in malls, and they really come out with some amazing flavors in their teas. And here's one called Wonderberry Chocolate Truffle. And so if anybody wants to take a whiff of this one later on, you're welcome to. And let's see, and for drinks, or other drinks, there's a chocolate beer. This is put out by Samuel Smith, the British. And this is like $11 in binnies now for a four pack. And there, it actually has a chocolate taste. Almost 90% of the other ones, no real chocolate taste in beer. They're just using the name for marketing, basically. They may have some chocolate in it, but the taste doesn't come through at all. Another little souvenir, just a cow parade. Chocolate milk thing. Godiva makes a chocolate liqueur, Vandermint, and look around and let's see, there's a lot of blends with chocolate wine now.
Is that chocolate? Because they have milk chocolate and dark chocolate. This is dark?
This is called Wineheart, and I actually just picked this up. I haven't tried it, but Choco Vin is actually fairly good. It's a combination of wine and chocolate.
Wow.
But you can try some of the different ones and see what you like for personal taste, because there's a number of them out now, and I haven't sampled them. Some are possibly gimmicky, but I know the chocolate bin is good.
It's good with potato vodka. Two shots of that.
Mom, could you take a piece of chocolate?
Seriously, it takes the edge off that, off the vodka and really makes it palatable.
Okay, good. And
it's good with a blend called 42 Below they make out of Australia.
This is a book on chocolate in New York City. A lot of resources there. And there's one other book on chocolate in New York City. So you can find them on Amazon. Here's a little book by a Australian psychologist called Chocolate Therapy. It tells you how crazy you are along different lines, like what shapes you wad your paper wrappers up, your tinfoil wrappers up into, whether you like the round chocolates, the square, crunchy, creamy, all those sorts of things. Really cute, fun little book. And there's some good info in it too. And a lot of these you can find at a half-price bookstores. This is a real cute little one for a gift. It's sort of comic book style, but real good information in it. Cook's Guide to Chocolate's a good one. And All About Chocolate, excellent. Chantel from the Chocolate Companion with this chocolate food of the gods that's very good. And National Geographic put out a book called Food Journeys of a Lifetime. And it's a big book. I didn't bring it. It's normally like a $40-$50 book. But it's down to about $10 or $15 now because it was a sleeper and nobody picked up on it. But you could be like right around the corner from some of the best sort of food in the world and not even know it. And they did their homework. So that's worth picking up, and it's got a good section on chocolate in it. And that's basically what I've got. But if there's any topics I missed, it'll probably, if you mention them, they'll come to mind. Otherwise, any other okay, good.
I just got a question for you.
Sure.
Let's thank our speaker first.
Yeah, years ago, right?
And Peter, Peter's got something. Here's some. I don't know.
We make two types for you: his Peter brand and American brand.
So you might want to chop that one up first, so they can you can sort of contrast them back and forth. Okay, any other questions, comments? We're open for anything.
Okay,
Brahm. Yeah, you're obviously something of an expert and a connoisseur of chocolates throughout the world. What got you interested in this? I mean, we all love chocolate, but loving it and studying it and becoming an expert at it are two entirely different things.
What's okay, got a good little story here for you. I had some friends in Germany that their daughter was getting married to someone from Belgium. And this was back at a time when it was sort of a lot harder to make arrangements to get to Europe. And so I really tried to get over there but couldn't make it. And the daughter sent me a box of chocolates that just stopped me in my tracks. So then the next time I went to Europe, I just ran into this little book on European chocolate. And it was excellent. And I came back with 35 different kinds of chocolate.
Whoa.
I lived in Tampa, Florida at the time. There was an open university. And they heard I did this. They called me up and said, hey, come and do us a chocolate class. And I said, well, I don't know anything about doing any chocolate class. And they said, I'll just do it. So I went down to the library and checked out all the books they had on chocolate and then did the class. So, and been having to painfully do all this research ever since. So.
Okay, I would like to ask you what's your opinion about this cherry. Cherry? Huh? Yeah. Okay, you know, they do
some
like...
Some other people's talk.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
Just keep it short, but...
Yeah. Different types of... So, for instance, I like dark chocolate cherry, you know, like cherry inside.
Right.
So my question is, again, if we return to dollar store, they're also selling like cherry chocolate. Okay. So, my question to you, first of all, if you like cherry chocolate, or women like more like cherry chocolate, and if you like it, what kind, you like darker or milk cherry chocolate, and what's your opinion, what is better,
okay.
Milk or
now
dark?
The Queen Anne chocolates that they usually sell around Christmas time, they're usually extremely sugary. If you, the Moncherie, I think, that come from Germany. When they come over here, there's some sort of liquor laws that they can't get around, so they actually put their hazelnuts in the ones here.
I don't like
if you bring them in from Europe, they have the chocolate bread, or they have the cherry brandy with the actual cherries in it. The Moncheries are excellent if you get them in Europe. Fortram and Mason in London, excellent cherry chocolates. But they have two kinds. One has the seed in it, one doesn't. I didn't differentiate one time and almost broke a tooth. So just in case that, I'll give me just a second. There's one area I forgot, and that's if you're in Europe. Both London and Paris, excellent for chocolate. Madrid, but any city around Paris. But Harrod's Food Court in London brings in Belgian, French, everything. Just amazing. And also Galleries Lafayette in Paris. Okay?
Thank you. There used to be, I think it might still be, a confectionery. They called them, I think, Jamaica beans. And they were like a sugary, a sort of a sugar shell with a rum liquid in them and then coated in chocolate.
Oh yes, they're the German ones. Bohnen, B-O-H-N-E-N is the German word for beans. And I think they've got one other word they put in front of it. But they are excellent. They have a band, a little
They used to call them Jamaica beans.
I haven't seen that terminology, but from what you're describing, this is what I've seen. Maybe that was sort of like a local terminology, but the Germans, I would say, started it. And actually, the Asbach Lindt factory in Rüdesheim, Germany, is where you can probably get some real interesting ones.
Okay? West Wagger?
What about growing your own chocolate in a greenhouse or something?
A lot of work. The chocolate pods, you could probably look up a picture on the web. They actually grow off the trunk of the tree, or possibly the branches. But it's sort of an unusual tree, and it has a beautiful flower, but very, very small flower. So.
Can you grow chocolate trees in a greenhouse?
Yeah, I think they've actually got one up in Minnesota at their botanical garden.
They have one in Lincoln Park.
You can do it. It's just the temperature has to be high and protected from freezing.
Right. I'll interrupt to say he brought some. So in addition to the Hershey product, you get to try what the professor recommends.
Yeah, just take one so everybody gets some maybe.
Everyone can
And what you can try and do is maybe go back and forth between
a couple hands.
One and the other just to see what you can differentiate. And actually, if people want to tell us what they discover from doing that, I'm open for that too. Or how much time do we have?
We got plenty.
We got a lot of time. I'll let you
have 15 minutes till the rebuttal period. But
okay.
Since given the kind of conversation, let's see. Linda, had a question. Tim, I think you did.
Yeah, I did. But let's stop.
All right, okay, we'll field the questions. Okay.
You Dave, Zucker, and then Charlie.
First of all, you can also find a cacao tree growing in Lincoln Park at the conservatory there.
Okay, good tip.
Two, I realize that you probably don't like either of these two brands, but if somebody put a gun into your head and said, which is better, Mars or Hershey's, which one would you favor?
Oh, Mars for sure. A big jump there for me.
Okay, thank you.
So why it's named Mars? Why they named Mars?
Just a brand name.
Name for the Mars family.
Before I sample this chocolate.
Wait a minute. Linda had her hand.
All right.
Yeah, but now I got my mouth
full. All right, Charlie.
If you don't mind, I can take somebody else.
Charlie, and then.
All right. Before I sample this chocolate, a few years ago at the college here, we showed a video and I spoke on something called the dark side of chocolate. That this stuff was harvested by children. And do you know, or are your other pals, yes, the chocolate industry, addressed this issue?
I actually haven't heard of that. It probably is very possible, and you know, it probably depends on what country and what companies, whether it's done humanely or not, because, I mean, I worked as a child on the farm here in this country, and the laws against children working on farms here were non-existent, basically. So So, but the other issue that maybe brings up is maybe the free trade and organic.
That's what that's about.
And I'm not real up on that. If anybody is, maybe they can, you sort of enlighten the group. But my guess is that we've got the middlemen maybe giving the growers a penny more and then taking the, and doubling the price and then upping their profits just for saying they're more humane.
Okay,
but I'm not sure on any of this. I haven't had the resources to check that out.
Okay, Ernie?
Yeah, can you tell us where most of the beans come from? And are there any beans, to speak of, grown in the United States?
Not really in the United States. The Carrillo bean is supposed to be one of the best, and it's going to be all just in that band across the equator throughout the whole world.
Okay.
And then, of course, you can get, a lot of it depends on the climate at the time.
That's right.
In that particular place, the care taken with the plants and with the product, and generally they'll cut open the cocoa bean, dump the inside into a vat and ferment it, and then dry it, and then process it from there. Oh, and actually chocolate museums I missed. Ghirardelli in San Francisco's got a good chocolate museum. There's one in Brussels. There's one in the middle of the Rhine, just below the Cologne Cathedral, called Stolberken in Germany. Strasbourg has got a good chocolate museum. There's one in Barcelona and another one in Spain for Valor chocolate. There's a big Lindt factory outlet up by Aachen, Germany. And I'll quit there.
Mike Foley had one.
Okay, do it, and then we'll get back to her too.
The Fannie Mae company, are they regional, national, and where do you rate them on your scale?
I would say as a candy, they're pretty good, and it's been a while since I've tasted them, so I don't. I'm not up to date on them. Anybody else have any?
Is it regional or is that across the United States? Or
I haven't really seen them in other parts of the country that much. So I think it's mostly around here.
Okay, and then
I have two things to say that aren't really questions, but I can turn them into questions. But
well, go ahead, just whatever you want to say.
Okay, just I Googled and found La Maison de Bonbon. There's one in Andersonville and one in Forest Park, Illinois. And then also I've heard of River Forest chocolates on Lake Street in River Forest, which might be very affluent chocolates, but I wondered if you had ever heard of those, so that's the question. And then just another aside, the other night we were watching television, they were talking about the drought in California affecting almond growing. Bless you. And how it takes gallon of water a week to grow one almond, and just, you know, what are your thoughts on how that will affect chocolate-covered almonds?
My guess is that if they don't get them from California, they'll get them somewhere else around the world, and the price will maybe go up a little bit. But I actually don't watch television much. Very, very, very minimal. So I'm not up on news sorts of things. But your web might be the best way to keep checking on that. So, thanks.
Mr. Foley had one.
What is it about Hershey's that you don't seem to care for? Is there a problem or?
Just that it possibly might have some chocolate in it. So, but I mean, actually taste the Hershey's next to regular chocolate. But I can say I'm not condemning personal taste. If you like Hershey's and it makes you happy, that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah, can you make some comments on the often reported health advantages of dark chocolate versus the milk chocolate and other varieties. Mm-hmm. Is it really as good for you as it has been made out to be?
I would say it can be, but if you see exaggerated claims, don't believe them. And I'll give you a good reference. There's a book called Why Women Need Chocolate. And it was done by a dietitian, and she really did her homework. I've got the book, but I'm not a woman, so I didn't read it. Just skimmed it.
What's the substitute for chocolate?
I can't quite pull it in. A substitute for chocolate?
Why? No, why would you do that? A substitute?
I never really paid Carol. That's what it is, Carol.
Some sort of mock chocolate.
Yeah, there is carob, but it just doesn't cut it.
I don't like
for me, anyway.
But isn't that what it's derived from anyway? Carob is cocoa beans or what?
What is it?
I actually don't know on carob. I wasn't interested.
That comes from another tree.
Yeah.
It's almost as bad. It's almost as bad as Robusta beans and coffee.
Well, I think some of the coffee is maybe dyed sawdust too.
Jerry, are you aware in Mexican cuisine there's a sauce? I think it's mole sauce.
Mole. Yeah. You can find it at the Mexican markets. It doesn't have a lot of chocolate taste to it, but it is actually a chocolate product. I recommend it just for the tasting. And Mexican cuisine, I think, is actually, you know, real Mexican cuisine, not the mock, is rated one of the higher cuisines in the world.
I heard that the mole has about 50 spices in it. 50 different ingredients.
Right.
Like real mole. With chocolate, of course.
It depends on probably where you get it.
Yeah.
You know, and you can find prepackaged. And I would imagine you get down to Mexico, some of the good cooks would say, oh, we don't want any of that packaged stuff. But I mean, it's really worth playing with. Like I mentioned, the drinking chocolates that come from the Latin countries that have all the different spices in, they're fairly inexpensive, and you can play with them and learn things.
David Zucker?
Yes, could you comment on whether the Aztecs had chocolate and whether they put pepper in there instead of sugar?
They did put pepper in. And I'm not sure on, I would guess they had some sort of sweetener in. I don't remember everything they put in it, but chilies and vanilla. Had the papantla, the town of Papantla in Mexico is where they grow the vanilla orchids that make vanilla. It's pretty interesting little area. It's north of Veracruz, roughly 100 miles along the eastern coast.
What's your favorite kind of chocolate?
Probably the Maison. This is interesting too. I did get a class from, Robert Link's Maison du Chocolat, Paris. Mm-hmm. That is supposed to be the best chocolates in the world.
Where is it?
Maison du Chocolat in Paris, and they actually have a branch in New York now. They're expensive now, but I got a class from him just because I happened to know who he was, and they brought him to New York. And I had a cousin that was living just outside of New York City. I got a class that the Chocolatier magazine put on for $30. So, pretty interesting.
Are you saying Mason or Maison?
Maison means house.
House. So that's what you're saying.
Right.
Yeah.
Maison Chocolat in Paris. And if you get to Paris, there are just all sorts of just amazing shops. And France probably has the best sort of handmade chocolates, but Belgium does an excellent job for low-priced manufactured chocolates. Excellent for the price. You can get like three Belgian chocolates for every perfect French handmade chocolate. So you can do your own arithmetic there.
Okay, Abby? Have you traveled through all those countries getting all the information from these factories and places and things?
Yes, I have.
So did you live in Europe for quite a while?
No, I would just generally go over, and when I go over, I try and stay a month to make, you know, the airfare and all the other expenses. And then I try and stay with local people, and I, you know, check out what they knew, and I would hit some of these chocolate.
How many years have you been doing that?
Oh, probably since the early 60s.
So how do you keep your weight down?
quality over quantity. So that'll do it. Oh, yeah, if you get the really good stuff.
Or just walking the long road to each shop, right?
Yeah. If you get the really good stuff, you don't need
a lot. Okay. There's no obesity in Paris, you know?
Right, yeah. Okay, yes.
This is not a pathetic attempt at clandizement. However, are you familiar with Butler's Chocolates
in Ireland?
In Cork? Yeah.
Yeah.
How do you rank it?
They're decent for the price. They really are. Yeah. So.
How about Butler's Chocolate?
Yeah. Where do you stand on chocolate ice cream?
Generally fairly decent, and usually I would go to Häagen-Dazs. And I wouldn't, I think they've gotten some new interpretation of gelato that they made up themselves. And I think their regular ice creams are better than their gelatos, which are supposed to be the premium quality. But, you know, they're, depends on which one you get, too, or which flavor. So, and I don't, or the, another resource is the custard in Milwaukee. If you haven't been to Milwaukee and done the frozen custard, let's see. I'll think of the place in the minute.
Is it Leon's?
Leon's is excellent. And what's the other big one? That's
Andy's.
I don't remember that one, but I'll think of the other one. Okay.
So what do you think about peppermint chocolate? Do you like peppermint chocolate?
Yes, peppermint goes with chocolate very well.
Not very often, right?
Sometimes. I usually don't eat it that often, but the Dutch liqueur called Van der Mint is combination.
Do you like ice cream, like peppermint chocolate ice cream?
Yeah, I like it. But everything is personal taste here.
Yeah,
so
that's true.
But you may not like it, he may love it and not like anything else, whatever.
Yeah.
Because everyone's taste buds are different, honestly. Right, so these are all generalizations that, you know, you can play and work with. Well, in fact, in terms of play, I've got a little bit of background on the anthropology of play. If you know the TED Talks.
Oh, yeah.
There's a fellow by the name of Stuart Brown. So if you search Stuart Brown play on a TED Talk, he does just an excellent job of the concept of play that is really how we should be living rather than nose to the grindstone and on the hamster wheel. So, from my take. Any comments on the tasting of the chocolates?
I didn't get any.
Oh.
Any left?
It was an unfair comparison because the European also had nuts in it.
Okay.
But the European was clearly better.
We'll accept that.
Team,
the European
question.
Was better.
What do you think about some of the new innovation going on out in Colorado with blending the chocolate with a few ingredients of THC?
I'm not up on that. Can you fill us in on a little bit?
Well, there was a hearing that was done by the Senate against one of these state legislatures about whether they were going to legalize pot or not. And the thing they were doing was, look what happened in Colorado and how bad it's gotten. The next thing you know, you saw these parade of THC-laced chocolate, THC-laced teas, THC-laced this, and I'm thinking to myself, these legislators, they're killing their own goose. Look at all this neat stuff that's coming in. It's just like the liquor industry.
I always thought vitamin E and chocolate would be a good combination to sell, you know, instead of Viagra and chocolate or something.
Ooh. So, hey, you do it with calcium, right? Okay. Yeah.
Calcium. Cal Mag and Zinc, yeah. That's the other, that's usually a question I get, is this chocolate an aphrodisiac? Anything that, you know, is sort of stimulating can be, so. I guess Marquis de Sade sort of thought it was, but then he also had
Charlie?
The rich thing in it, too.
Yeah, Greg, do you know if, I guess they generally only do name brands, but are any chocolates?
David, would you like more ice water?
That's what I had thrown out as an open question, and I'm not sort of really up on the fair trade, like say what I was guessing was that some
THC
of the marketers are putting that on the label, doubling the price and then only giving the farmer a minimal, but I'm not up on it. It's probably hard to check up on. The two other areas that I want to mention too is on storing chocolate. If you store chocolate, what I would do, don't let it get hot. You can put it in plastic Ziploc bags and put it in the refrigerator. If you also do that, it keeps them from sort of evaporating if they have liquid in them. And as far as for a recipe for fondant, you take maybe 2 cups of shaved or fine chocolate and 1 cup of cream or milk.
You put
the milk up in a saucepan until just before boiling, pull it off the heat, and then melt your chocolate in it, and then you can add your ingredients like your cherry brandy or your nuts or your vanilla, a little more sugar if you want it, and things like that. That's the basis, and that will get you the inside, which is the fondant. But then, like say, on the normal manufacturing, they do the tempered chocolate over top.
I'm sorry,
The one other area is liquor chocolates. Liquor chocolates are usually done fairly well, but what I would suggest is I get out of the store, open it up, and look at the bottom of one. Because if they're old, they'll dehydrate. And all you get is sort of like a sugar mess.
Sugar, right. It's like more like crunchy.
And
sugar.
So then take them back in the store and say, hey, these aren't any good anymore. I want my money back. But usually the bottom will be indented quite a bit if that has happened. And then, like I say, putting those in a plastic bag, a chocolates helps that evaporation stop too.
Charlie, you still have a question?
Okay.
Okay. We are holding you up here for quite a while.
Just small comment.
Fine.
Small comment. Also, you know what I recommend? One more. It's called Prozit. You know, Prozit. It's like Prozit. You know Prozit?
Okay. Yeah, it's a German idea,
right.
So
it's like really like with lit. Right. It's like little bottles, chocolate bottles, and inside a room, different type of liquor. Oh, it's so. Good.
You should have brought some.
That's what how I spoiled. I'm very spoiled by chocolate. Good. You know.
Okay.
European.
Yes.
Can I ask you? Sometimes you buy chocolate and it's kind of white. Does that mean it's?
That's called bloom. It's just been heated up a little bit, good. And it really doesn't hurt anything.
Oh, it doesn't.
No.
Okay. Good.
All right, David.
Yes. First of all, as I understand it, there are two kinds of liquor chocolate. The first kind is a chocolate shell that's got liquor in a liquid form inside the shell. Second is some that I got like last year when I was at a distillery in Kentucky, where the whiskey is simply laced all through the chocolate with a pecan on top. And that's absolutely delicious.
Okay.
Last of all, where do you stand, and this is the last question I'm going to ask, Where do you stand on the issue of chocolate milk?
Generally, it's way loaded for sugar, with sugar, the commercial products. And I buy it maybe once a year, just for a taste treat if I run into a good one. But it's overloaded with sugar is my general opinion.
Well, all right.
One more. Last one.
I think it's...
Go for it. This is important. Any information?
We generally break off about 8 o'clock so that we have about an hour for people to inform us their own experiences and opinions.
I'm going. I'm going.
The rebuttal period.
Let's get this started.
Let me just sneak it in.
Well, I know you've been standing here for... an hour and a half.
I love it. Good questions. It's a good group because, you know, some people just sit there, really. We'll take him. Go
something
ahead.
Something dear to the hearts of many...
have you ever seen a real live Oompa Loompa?
I think I've heard the term once. I've seen a Volpertinger.
No, it's a character. It's a character from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Oh, yes, chocolate movies! Glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
There are some good chocolate movies.
Yeah.
Okay. People should know.
Le Chocolat.
Chocolat.
Water for chocolate. Water for chocolate.
They like water for chocolate. Another good one. There's the Willy Wonka one, and there's one more.
Modern Marvels, History of Chocolate.
Oh, I didn't write that one down, Peter. What is it?
What about the Cinnamon Bear?
I hadn't heard of that one.
I think they had, it's a very old Christmas radio cartoon-like, but it has some chocolate things in it.
Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Ooh.
Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Almost. Yes. Reference.
It's
a reference. And there's... let's see, Hot Chocolate is a cute one. The fellow that was in Airplane is in it, and I think, what was the gal that was in the movie 10?
Bo Derek
is in it. So, and it's a fun one. It's done in France with some beautiful architecture, too.
Oh, there is one that was, I think it may have been somewhat French. It's supposed to be about people in France who... get undermined all their morality by chocolate. and our pastor showed it. In our biblical studies class.
if anybody comes up with any of those fun resources, get them to Peter, and he'll get them back to me, too, because I love to hear any of that stuff. So, in fact, I got a chance to hang out with Harrison Owen a number of times, who developed the open space technology process for developing the intelligence of groups. And that's what we should be doing rather than having experts up here, because I think it's far more efficient.
So, I have suggestion. So it sounds very nice from you. Maybe you can establish excursion for this group who interested to about chocolate to learn more. And maybe somewhere in Illinois, maybe some excursion. Maybe you can establish, and maybe you can be like leader.
Okay, we can maybe do a chocolate Saturday or something down here sometime. I can come down.
Wow.
With Peter.
Oh, it's
so we'll see. We'll sort of just put that on the burner and see what we can do.
Okay.
But good idea. Thanks.
Let's get into rebuttals.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Do
we have a rebuttal?
Seeing as I don't have a clock, I'm going to need somebody to time me out at 5 minutes.
I got you.
Okay, and this will be toning for official postmaster's credit because Peter Perro is going to evaluate me on this. Tonight, I never thought I would see what I saw at the College of Complexes.
Wow.
Agreement.
I saw people talking about things
like markets. Different market and spatial differentiation from chocolate. The ability to vote with your dollars as to what the best one is. And, needless to say, globalization in action by talking about the various regions and market economies that have been brought in. Need I say more what the glories of what capitalism can bring to a good old-fashioned business innovation model? It all works like this. There's a certain amount of need that's been brought in by a consumer or a certain taste and preference. Somebody with an entrepreneurial flair comes out and finds a rather unique niche product for it, because what's the goal? They need to make money to make a living. And if they can do it, it's something they like, that's a good thing. You know, we often say that, you know, when we think of capitalism today, we think of the mass-produced factory goods. But it's globalization has brought us a lot of fancy manufactured goods. But there is one thing that we neglect, and that is what really sells product and what really sells a good, high-quality chocolate. And that is the arts component of the chef or the company and the artistic abilities brought into the market and the marketing of that brand, the packaging that that brand produces. So if you're in the creative arts field, there's a lot of work that needs to be done, especially for various companies and various places that might want to do things like this. You know, you see it in your segmentation of your grocery stores, everything from the former Dominick's to Jewel to now Whole Foods to Trader Joe's to everything else. And we in our country have it great because we don't spend that much percentage of our income on food like they do in other countries. I think the average American family spends roughly 5 to 7% of its annualized income on food, and versus like up to 20% in other countries. The thing that really I want to bring out tonight is that what you saw tonight with the various combinations of taste, of preference, of one business over another, is exactly what capitalism in its pure form can bring. Good, high-quality products, good, high-quality taste, good artisans bringing good products to work. And we're starting to see that now even in our upper-end manufactured goods. It's been known around the United States that our manufactured goods have actually quadrupled in the last 20 years, with a lot less of a workforce being involved. But they're also now segmenting a lot of those products into various niches. For example, our auto companies are now finally again beginning to differentiate by cars and what people like. Look at Tesla Motors, for example, with the innovations that are coming out with the electric car. And even in the nuclear power field, they're finally starting to innovate now with some newer type of reactors for things that I've talked about previously. So, to all you guys who still think that socialism works, what you get is a bland, dull marketplace of the same generic stuff and not the revitalization of products that come in to a good marketplace where you get diverse products, diverse choice, and of course many of the benefits that the market provides. And if a guy does it well and does it good, he's going to win. Thank you.
Globalization.
Okay,
you know. Yeah. How many children were at work today?
I have no idea.
Very good.
Peter, very good.
You're going to be gone next weekend, right?
Yeah, I will.
My idea was the Long Grove Chocolate Festival, possibly, and tying in with your idea, possibly we could meet there like noon on Sunday or something.
Okay.
Where?
Would that work?
Where?
The Long Grove Chocolate or Long Grove, in Long Grove.
Yeah.
Oh, where's Long Grove?
It's possibility to maybe establish some transportation, like group transportation.
I'll post something on my website or give some information to Charlie about the Long Grove Festival. I'll do it when I get home tomorrow.
Yeah, you'll have to organize. So I'm like 4 hours away, so if it's organized from down here, I'm going to actually be in Milwaukee Friday and Saturday, but I can come down here Sunday from there.
Long Grove's only about 20 minutes from me, so.
From where?
From Algonquin.
Yeah, but from.
Okay.
Are
you timing to?
No, you're.
My experience with the chocolate film that I mentioned was that the joy, the morality, the very Christian morality that was upset by the joys of chocolate. That morality wasn't worth that very much, and the joys of the chocolate and the sharing of the joys of the chocolate was worth a great deal. And so, it reminds me that my first experience with Henry Cadbury and family. Cadbury was a chocolate heir. Now, Henry Cadbury was a Quaker. The Cadbury chocolate people are Quakers. And they partially financed the American Friends Service Committee, amongst other things, in which Henry Cadbury was very active. Now, Henry Cadbury was a New Testament scholar from Yale University, and a great scholar, and the Friends Service Committee sponsored a summer institute in, I've forgotten the term for it, where it was a group living experience in the factories of Lynn, Massachusetts, where we learned what it was to be a worker in the factories of Lynn, Massachusetts. I worked in a hospital because it had hospital work experience. Henry Cadbury was, and his family lived with us, and also a Buddhist monk, and we had one of the most beautiful experiences of my life many years ago. So that's what Henry Cadbury and chocolate remind me of. So. Okay, next.
Boy, Bob. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I want to say that this is not a night when, even though this is our rebuttal period, this is not a night when there will be very many rebuttalers because everyone is so fond of chocolate. But I'm a true rebuttaler, and I'm going to tell you that to begin with, chocolate is very bad for you. Don't believe this business where people tell you that chocolate is good for you.
Yes, it's
not good for you because they tell you out of the other side of their mouth, the experts that is, that you should never give your dog chocolate. That it's very bad for a dog. But then they turn right around and tell you, dogs can eat anything. So if dogs can eat anything, and chocolate is bad for dogs, then think how bad it must be for us. But I'm not even gonna talk about that.
Why are you being dogs?
Will you please pipe down?
You pipe down.
I'm going.
Yeah.
You've been going all night long. Now just pipe down.
No, why are you
now,
being
as
dope?
I,
it's not here.
As I was saying.
You cannot spoil.
Thank you.
No felonies. No felonies.
As I was saying.
No felonies.
That for those of you who are socialists or left-wingers, I'm sorry to disillusion you, but you're going to have to give up chocolate. Because chocolate is a bourgeoisie device that was invented for the rich, and since the capitalists own all the big companies and means of production, it's a gimmick to get you to spend your money on chocolate so that they can be rich and live big, and you can get fat and get ill from eating chocolate. And the thing about telling you that eating chocolate is good for you, this is propaganda on a similar par as my doctor smokes Chesterfields. So therefore, you have to know that the chocolate, and I'll prove to you that chocolate is absolutely anathema to socialism or communism. There's no chocolate that was from the Soviet Union. You never heard of Soviet chocolate. There's no Cuban chocolate. There's no Chinese chocolate. There's no North Korean chocolate.
There
so
is.
On a separate thing, I'm simply going to tell all of you that when you, that I was talking to a friend of mine, and I asked him, I said, by the way, I said, where do nuts grow? And he said, oh, well, nuts grow on trees. I said, you haven't seen the ones at the College of Complexes.
Next. Next.
Encore.
Encore. Encore.
Encore.
In my chair.
Oh, oh my goodness.
Where's Tim?
You broke.
Tim.
Tim,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Clock?
I have it. He's got the clock.
In 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll try to stay within the allotted 5 minutes, maybe less. Hello. My name is Andy Anderson. And a question I've been wrestling with for a long time. First, I'd like to congratulate our speaker.
Yeah.
As far as I'm able to tell, he gave a totally reality-based, fact-based presentation. Quite the opposite from some of the presentations we have here that are fantasy-based. With no basis in reality.
Like next week's 9/11 debate.
All of you take a look at the schedule. There are, if you're familiar with any of the topics that are listed here, I'm familiar with some of the speakers. I won't mention any names, but we have four speakers, are excellent speakers at giving classic, vanity-based, denialist speeches. Total denial of documented reality. There are four of those on this schedule somewhere in here. And there are at least four that are speakers that are good at giving reality-based, fact-based discussions. The reason that I point this out to all of you, before you guys end up leaving,
no.
We'll take a minute for the interruption over there. Okay, are we back to normal here?
Yeah.
No, it wouldn't be the college if we were.
Yeah.
Normal.
Now, on July 25th, for all those of you that are interested, I'll have a series of books up here that will help you be more efficient at determining whether somebody is uninformed. They're just terrifyingly ignorant, or they're expressing an opinion. They're not lying to you. They believe what they're saying, even though it's positively false. How can you tell the difference between a person that is sincere and honest and out of touch with reality versus somebody that is a merchant of doubt, a specialist in promoting denial? Like we're talking about the tobacco strategy, where after the facts are all in and the answer is known,
then you pay professors and other people from various scientists, you pay them to create doubt. To basically stand up in front of a judge, right hand up and say, Your Honor, the earth is flat, trust me. The tobacco industry did that. Those guys were standing up, seven CEOs testifying in 1994 with their hands up under oath. We have no evidence that nicotine is addictive. We have no evidence that secondhand smoke is harmful to children. They just basically, they stand up. As Ed Schultz said, Ed Schultz from MSNBC said, if you're a conservative and you're trying to combat the body of fact after the forensic evidence is all in, the way you win a debate is you stand up there at the podium and just lie your ass off until the time runs out. And that's what we've seen here at the college. People have buried the audience in total bullshit until the 3 hours was up, and there was no information that took place during those classic evenings. So I'm going to address that issue specifically because Brahm has asked Brahm and a few others have asked me, say we shouldn't say a man is lying, call anybody a liar. Well, what do you call somebody that is intentionally lying to you? They know it's a lie, a bald-faced lie. They stand up at the podium and do a presentation, like a man stood up here and did a presentation on how we should build nuclear power plants everywhere. Well, I asked him in the parking lot, I said, how many of you expect to be built on American soil? He says, none. I said, well, what'd you give that presentation for? He said, oh, well, maybe we'll influence China. No, the information is...
And you're completely misquoting him out of context, too.
No, I'm not misquoting him, and... The reason I say this is Professor Griffin's new book on climate change called Unprecedented, he addresses the problem. He says, we have problems, and if you don't face the reality of it in time, you can't effectively implement solutions. So that book, Unprecedented, is loaded with solutions of what people are doing all over the world. To first of all say there's no debate on this issue anymore. After the facts are in, when somebody stands up and gives you a denialist lie, it's a lie. And we have to call them out on it. So thank you.
All right. Mr. Butler.
Mr. Butler.
Did you notice something here tonight? Something unusual for the College of Complexes. There was no disagreement here. Nobody called each other or their mothers dirty names. Nobody acted like some spoiled brat backbencher in the British Parliament, where they're notorious for interrupting each other. Everyone behaved like perfect ladies and gentlemen. So to say that chocolate is the tool of the rich to anesthetize the rest of us, I would have to say, give me more anesthesia, Doc. I admitted at the beginning of this meeting, using the formula that I'm sure has been heard by many of our friends, not necessarily here, when I said, hi, my name is Pat, and I'm a chocoholic. The truth of the matter is, if there is one thing people seem united on, it's chocolate. The Aztecs viewed it as the food of the gods. One of the first things the Spanish conquistadors took and made their own, after thinking they discovered it, was chocolate. About the same time they were pulling the gold out of the treasuries in the halls of Montezuma, they were also carrying away chocolate plants or whatever to enable them to enjoy that same drink over there. Chocolate became very popular in advanced European countries in the 15, 1600s. It is the one thing, perhaps, that has unified
this esteemed body in all the years that I have come here. We can disagree over pot. We can disagree over the virtues of booze. We can disagree over religion. We certainly disagree over political parties. But we all tonight, for perhaps the one time that we're going to see here in our lives, agreed on one thing. Chocolate is good.
Especially Butler chocolate.
I agree with just about everything that Pat said. Now, I've been coming here to the college now for some 14 years. And Pat was right. I have never, in the 14 years that I've been coming here, have seen the room so quiet, so unanimous. Nobody insulted anybody. Nobody screamed at anybody. Nobody had to walk out of here.
You're not done. We're not done.
Well, so far, so good. To those who say, not done, I say that I quote from an old-time television commercial. Sorry, Charlie, only the best-tasting tuna get to be star-kissed. I would like to say, however, that when the Aztecs drank their chocolate, they did not, in fact, put a sweetener in it. They mixed it with pepper. And it was when they came to Spain that the Spaniards said, oh, we can improve this. And they took the pepper out and mixed in sugar for the first time. And that's when chocolate acquired the sweet taste that everybody is familiar with. What else was I going to say? Well, I guess that's it. Thank you.
All right, let's thank our speaker for bringing all his wonderful things and a few little sample treats there. I'll be eclectic as usual. For some reason, unbeknownst to myself, I have cable TV, and I watch the Food Channel, where they manufacture for featuring, of course, food products found in grocery stores and available in other outlets. Very often, they've had a series on candy and its manufacture. And all the various brands, and many brands I'd never heard of, they even go into Canada. And it's somewhat interesting. If you have occasion, I could highly recommend it. Because you see this, especially some of the things that we're talking about here tonight, range from those that are highly mechanized, such as the American companies, these candy bar manufacturers, to apparently these fine chocolates, which are just the opposite and almost entirely handmade. So it's kind of interesting to see. The other thing is, we have, four taste buds, sweet, sour, salty, and bitter. And I don't know why I researched taste at one time. Well, I was looking into the senses. I had some things on that. But there is a thing to satisfy our sweet taste buds. I'm thinking of the pioneer life, the pioneers. They used to be adults at the museum, but about the only manufactured product that you found in my log cabin, like Abe Lincoln's cabin, was a sugar cone. It was wrapped in packages, and they secured from the Caribbean. I mean, they had virtually no manufactured goods except for a few tools, metal products, and things of that nature. Mostly things are made in their local village, but a sugar cone was a common thing, and they had to protect it, of course. But you can see that even today, if you go to one of these pioneer villages and look around, and if they have any degree of authenticity, a sugar cone was a common little feature and a treat, you know, even in the pioneer life. Now, jumping around to another topic, I heard something here that why do not socialist countries? Certain socialist countries have
chocolate. And last I heard, or I was led to believe, that the chocolate, apparently talking about greenhouses, and I'm not an expert on the horticulture of chocolate, but I believe it grows on the equator.
Yep.
It's a tropical product, a tropical plant. Now the question was raised, why do countries such as North Korea don't have chocolate? Well, it could be because you can't grow it there. Why don't they have chocolate in the Siberia, Russia? I mean, they don't have chocolate in Lithuania.
That doesn't speak well for North America.
I guess it's due to their political, socioeconomic structure that they don't have chocolate, of course. It's got to be their embracing communism. It has nothing to do with the fact that it doesn't grow there. Now, I'm going to get serious with you. Now, I was not here last week, but I understand we hosted some people from the United Farm Workers. And the last I understand that Mike was telling me, didn't it focus on the exploitation of disadvantaged people in regarding the food industry? And then I come here tonight and I hear this great celebration of the food industry. But maybe is there by any chance some unfairness to this aspect of the food industry? Is there any possibility? Now, he's talking about the wonders of globalization.
Yeah.
And I believe there's a highly structured network, especially for these corporate candy manufacturers. And do you think those corporate candy manufacturers are just really benign and wonderful and nice and happy people? I also understand that the Hershey Corporation was accused of recruiting worldwide for students to run their factories, ostensibly to give them training in the American culture and importing employees at less than minimum wage. And I haven't followed this story. But anyhow, there's a little bit here underneath this industry. I don't really feel, I personally, since we're getting personal on some of these things, I don't eat a lot of chocolate. I've had a few chocolate bars, I think somewhere in the dark recesses of my refrigerator, for longer than I will care to admit. I think they've been there since I got it. I really don't consume it. If you do, that's perfectly fine. But let's not forget, where did it come from? There is a story behind this.
Yeah.
Also, please, if you're going to look up websites, you're looking up things, I suggest, sir, that you look up the website of the United Food and Confectionery Workers of America, mm-hmm. and find out what kind of candy they put this out for Halloween, Mother's Day, other holidays like that. Because I don't give any of my girlfriend's scab candy. Thank you. Very good.
Yes, I'll be very brief for a change. I forgot to mention in the announcements, Tom Berry, who runs our branch down in Dallas, will be here in Chicago next weekend. I don't know if he's planning on coming to college, but I'll try and talk to him and encourage him to do so. So any of you want to get together with Tom, give him a call, and he'll be in town. I just wanted to touch a little bit on some candy lore. We talked about Frango Mints, the history of Frango Mints. They were developed in 1918 at the Frederick and Nelson Department Store in Seattle, Washington. And the name comes from a couple of letters each from Frederick Nelson Company. They were called, not Frango, but Franco Mints originally,
yep.
for many, many years. Then, of course, the Spanish Civil War came along, and Generalissimo Franco became buddies with Adolf Hitler and some other folks. So they decided to change the name. and that's where the name Frango rather than Franco comes
oh,
from.
Oh, really?
Oh,
sure.
All
right. Any more rebuttals? Peter, can you give me a two-minute evaluation? Can you orally
well,
give me a two-minute deal?
About 5 years ago,
if you could,
when on the news there was a story about chocolate, dark chocolate being good for your health, and they gave us the study. I went on the internet. I found the study. It was a Swedish study, and basically. What it is that dark chocolate, not milk chocolate, but dark chocolate is a blood thinner along the lines of aspirin. So you can Google the study, you can read the study, I read the synopsis of the original study, and if you know anybody who's on a blood thinner, warfarin, anything like that, caution them against habitually eating dark chocolate, because it'll play havoc with their blood.
See,
did it say anything
you.
About the volume?
What about the brain?
It's not much. It's not much. It's about like an aspirin is not very big, and this is along the lines of an aspirin. But I would say like if you have a Hershey bar, a tab that you break off on a Hershey bar, if you were to take that every day, would be the same effect.
Okay,
okay. But look it up.
David, sweetheart.
Is there a warning label on that bar?
A few last points. Ernie only forgot one point when he was talking about the Tartan Frango maps. Namely, that in the late 40s, Marshall Fields bought out Frederick and Nelson.
Right.
And that's why we have Frango mints here in Chicago. Mm-hmm. Secondly, Tim spoke about capitalist innovation. I don't always agree with him on that score, but there's one point that should be worth noting. It was said earlier that chocolate was originally produced only for the rich and the bourgeois. And at one point, that was true, and it was too expensive, it wasn't available to even middle-class people, much less people at the bottom. Well, we may disagree with this gentleman on the subject of how good his chocolate is. And the fact remains that it was Milton Hershey who, by mass-producing chocolate, brought it down to a price that everyone could afford.
Yeah.
And it was at that point that chocolate ceased to be something available only to the rich, but became available to everyone.
Yes.
I'm not necessarily saying that I think that company makes the best quality chocolate. That's something that for other people to decide other than me.
Things have changed over the years too. It's corporate now.
Yes. And lastly, with regard to the comment that was made about, well, if it's not good for dogs, why isn't it good for us? This comment applies to cats, too, as well as dogs. Cats and dogs cannot digest, and their digestion is not built to digest sugar products or anything or chocolate. It is poisonous to cats and dogs. I mentioned this subject once, and the people I was with said, no, he's right. That's how some friends of mine poisoned their cat. Apparently, they gave it some chocolate and with unfortunate results. Cats and dogs do not eat sugar food with sugar in the wild. They don't even have taste receptors for sweet things. I don't think dogs do, and I know that cats do not. That's why I made sure when I had a cat that not only did he not get anything with sugar in it, he got no human table scraps, period. He got his cat food, his water, and some cat treats that help clean his teeth at the vet recommended. And that was it, and I thank you for the second.
Well, you're going to get cat
food. Very awesome. Uh-oh, look out.
Uh-oh.
This is going to be good.
This is going to be good.
Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, but virtually everything I said when I spoke here before was only in jest. It's interesting to know how that so many people take issue with all of these things. But it was all
thank you, Mr.
Yes. I meant no offense to anyone. However, I do honestly have to scratch my head and ask about one thing. If chocolate comes from equatorial countries, then why is it that the very best chocolate comes from Switzerland?
Because they're traitors, that's why.
I forgot to make an announcement.
Because they're what?
They're traitors.
Traitors to what?
Traitors.
I forgot to make one quick announcement about, for those of you, if you have any friends that are in the reality-based community and they want to know what's going on with one of the biggest pieces of mythology in America today, come next week. Historian Ted Aranda is giving a fact-based presentation on the myth of 9/11. So we'll have extensive literature, books. It'll be a great presentation. So come next week. Thank you.
All right.
The question was posed, why do they have chocolate industry in Europe? It's called colonization.
Markets and colonization. What's wrong with that? I know.
Ever heard colony?
Yes. And what's wrong with that?
A big country takes a little country, and what do they do to the products from the little country?
They export them.
They steal it.
They export them.
For themselves.
It develops
and
trade,
this is
Charlie.
Basically called, multinationalism, capitalism. Yes. To a third world country and extract anything of value for yourself.
What? It's called slavery, too.
Yes.
That's enslaving.
Speaker gets the last word. Speaker gets the last word. Let's thank him again for a wonderful presentation.
It's been fun and a great group. And something I ran into that I thought this group might be interested in, I was in England a number of years back before internet and things like this, and I ran into an organization called the Campaign Against the Arms Race. And just within the last couple of weeks I happened to think of that, and it's on the web, and it's got some of the best information on which countries manufacture arms for sales and how they start wars so they're able to sell them. So Campaign Against the Arms Race, and it just has the co.uk address on it. So it's there. Enjoyed it. Hey.
Thank you. Tim, I even put in a good word for capitalism.